future, talk radio will actually educate, inspire, and make you think. The future is now. Topics and music that affect your life from Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at ubnradio.com.
Go ahead.
It's the town where True Blood took place.
Bon okay.
Temps. Like, it means good times.
It means good times. Okay.
Right.
In 1 minute, we'll be back to good times. We're back.
Yay.
You're here with Deborah, Sarah Kobylt, Linda Hayes, and everybody welcome. And once again, I'm flying through the door.
I can't even believe you made
up the 101. I can't believe it either.
I almost had a heart attack. Thank you very much.
Why? Because of me?
Yes, or because of you. I'm like, get here. Just get here.
Well,
I don't care what you have to do.
You know, I always have a set time that I leave. And if I go 1 minute over, it doesn't work. For whatever reason, that extra minute. I mean, we all know about LA traffic, but I can't blame the traffic. If I leave 1 minute too late, traffic just starts to form. And then I'm driving down the freeway, not at a very safe pace.
That's what gives me a heart attack. And quite frankly, you cannot
I need
get
a driver.
In an accident.
I need a driver. That's
I think
what
you
I
need to leave 15 minutes earlier. That would be the easiest solution.
Everybody's in here laughing. It's like, Deborah, just get
we
it together.
We have a great show today.
Oh, my
we
gosh.
We are so excited
you
about
start it.
It
up. Go ahead.
Oh, my gosh. We have the most incredible actress here with us.
Beautiful.
Dale. She's
beautiful.
Making me, she's making me say the Dale Raoul.
Yes, pretty close.
You got it. You got
I wanna
it.
I want to say Dale is been in the acting Hollywood scene for, well, a long time. We won't give away your age because you look
That's
so
okay.
young and beautiful.
I don't care.
Well, 40 years, you said. That's
yeah.
the you are a seasoned
yes.
professional.
I'm a veteran.
A veteran, yeah. And you most recently, we'll get it to what you're working on now and
okay.
some things that came out, but True Blood is the most recent series that you were on. Tell us about that experience. I mean,
well,
it must have been incredible.
It was incredible. I mean, the great thing was we ran for 7 seasons, so it gave everybody a chance to get to know each other.
Oh, yeah.
It's like
that
a family.
That's fun, right? I mean, and then when it's over,
fun.
You're like,
oh my gosh,
what
you
happened?
Know,
where did everybody go?
Yeah. So people keep in touch, you know, definitely. And it was a great experience because I had a horrible, terrible character. I played like this racist, bigoted,
Ooh,
nasty.
Fun.
It was
I
fun.
I like that.
Yeah, it was really fun. And the writers were fabulous, and, you know, so they would write this crazy, insane stuff to come out of my mouth. So I had a wonderful experience.
Did when you were when you were walking around as an actress, you know, let's say you're going out to dinner, people think you're the character.
Yeah.
And
well,
so that must have been kind of hard.
You know, my character was very funny. So
okay.
people knew, like, you know, people would dress up as my character for Halloween and stuff like that. So it was really funny.
Did you ever dress up as your character for Halloween?
Oh, God, no.
That's a riot.
No, I had lots of polyester and big hair and big jewelry and, you know, big makeup. And it was a little over the top.
Did it take you a long time to get in makeup?
No, they had it down.
They had it down.
They
right.
had it down, maybe an hour. The hair was the main thing, was because it needed to be big.
Wow. How do you tap into a role like that? I mean, that's got to be a little
well,
tough, because it's always a little bit of who you are that you bring
yeah,
to the table,
that's
right?
Yeah, sure. Actually, you know, because the writers were so strong on that show, it was
Fantastic.
Pretty much on the page. But I must say, there were two or three people that I know in my life that I used elements of, even though I could never tell them that because it would be offensive.
Like,
but you can
yeah,
tell us.
No, I won't.
Yeah,
no,
sure
no,
you can.
Because you don't know those people.
Well, like
either.
Personality traits, or
yeah.
is it, I asked because you know I said my son does this, so I always
yes.
like to know the tricks of the trade. You know, it's
well,
interesting.
It's like somebody how somebody walks,
yeah,
or the way they sit, or the way they express themselves, maybe their rhythm.
Right,
or,
that's interesting. Isn't it?
You know, yeah, just by observing people, you can pick up a lot
right.
of
right. I remember I interviewed John Travolta once. This was like 20 years ago, and he said for every character, he creates a walk. That's what
right.
he does first. And I thought that was interesting.
Like well, every character,
if you look
he
at his characters, he's got a certain
well,
walk, stride, whatever it is.
A lot of people work. Yeah. A lot of people work outside in, a lot of people work inside out. And
okay.
because he's a dancer,
ah, that,
you
makes
know,
sense.
That makes sense that he would pick out some physical way to express the character.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense then. Yeah.
Yeah. Like a lot of people play music to figure out who they might be, or a lot of people, if they're women, they'll pick out a perfume that they think the character would wear, stuff like that. Or you know, if they would always wear high heels, they'd wear high heels in rehearsal, or, you know, whatever.
Those are interesting ways, you know, not being an actor, it's interesting for me.
Is so difficult, and a lot of
people don't realize
say,
that
as newscasters.
You don't think so? Dale, you think it's not? Or you?
No, I do. I do think it's difficult. I mean, it's a rigorous profession, and as everyone says, there's ups and downs and ups and downs. Not everyone, very few people ever get to be Meryl Streep.
Yeah.
So you know,
she's
sure
born
she,
that way. That's
yeah,
for sure.
But she
luck
you know,
and timing too. I mean,
yeah, but
you
also
know.
She's incredibly talented. Well, but yeah. I've heard her say many times that she's insecure and she doesn't think she can do it. And so, you know, it's just, it becomes a way of life. And so you get used to the downs as well as the ups, and it all kind of levels out.
So that's very healthy. You have good self-esteem.
Oh my gosh, I was just about to say, do you really have to tap into that? Because I think so many actors can be so self-conscious and feel like, gosh, I can't do it. I can't do it. Mm-hmm. Boom, the camera goes on and somehow you just turn into that character. You transform. Does it have something to do with just being on and then it comes out?
No, I don't think so. Not in my case. I have to be pretty prepared.
Really?
Because when you go into a set, you know, it's probably the first time you've ever met the other actors or been in the real location. So if you say you're going to be a secretary and you have to work the computer and, you know, file and you have props, it would be good if you could have rehearsed a bit at home to kind of know physically what you're going to do.
Right.
Otherwise, you're going to be freaked that, you know, you got to go over there to that file cabinet and then cross over here to this one and then answer the phone. And pretty soon your lines are going to go out that window.
And then you have to do several takes. So you kind of have to know what you did, right? You have to do the same thing
over and over. Yeah.
Wow. Well, you know what's funny? Before Deborah walked in, right at the nick of time,
but she
we
didn't.
Learned that she was on your favorite show, Elf.
Oh, God.
My favorite what?
Didn't you like Elf? Weren't we talking about that a long time ago?
Yeah, a while
Elf.
Ago.
Oh, I mean, it's a long time ago.
Oh, God, it was 100 years
what
ago.
What did you do on that show? Was it guest star or something like that?
Yeah, I did, but I kind of can't remember it.
Okay.
Honestly, it's been like
I know, I hate to put you on the
years.
Spot. It was just a good
I was,
story.
You know, and it was such a pain in the butt because Elf, I can't kind of remember, but they had troughs dug in the
what
the
to make
floor.
You like little and...
no not that because no. the puppeteer had to be under Elf.
I don't know.
Oh yeah, so we could maneuver
so
him.
The puppeteer was down on the floor and then with his hand up Alf's ass, I don't know what. And so it was all about Alf, you know, let's face it, it was all about
it was Elf's show.
It was Elf.
What was the first thing you ever did out here in Hollywood? Are you from here?
No, actually I grew up in the state of Montana.
Ooh, beautiful
yes,
place.
It's a very beautiful place to be from.
Oh, is it?
You know?
Not
well,
busy
I can't
enough.
Make a liver. I can't make a
yeah,
living there.
That's true.
Well, but, community theater maybe, but
yeah.
Yeah.
My first actual TV job, I played a nurse on Murder, She Wrote.
Oh, that's a good show too. That was a good show.
And I was very dazzled by Angela Lansbury because you know she was such a wonderful stage actress. So
she was it.
Yeah.
Was she nice? Did you meet
her?
She was
nice
to
me.
Talk to her.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was with her in the scene, and I remember being kind of like freaked because she had her bedroom slippers on. You know, I thought it was more a formal thing,
right?
And she said, "Oh, forgive me, I had garlic for lunch." And I thought, well, this is just a person.
Yeah, she's nice. She seems nice. Her character was great.
Yeah.
What a fun experience.
Anyway, yeah.
Great
I was
way
scared,
to start.
But,
yeah. Wow.
So now what are you doing? I mean,
got a great
couple of
movies, right?
Yeah, I just came back from Nashville. I did an episode of Nashville, which was really fun. And I also did I went to Charleston, South Carolina. Is that right? Charleston, North Carolina?
Yeah, well, there's...
Charleston, South Carolina. Forgive me. I went to Charleston, South Carolina. There's a new show coming.
It's confusing. Did they have to do that?
It is there.
I don't know. It's hot. That's all I know.
There's three Greensboros.
Exactly.
So you're not alone. People get confused.
Well, I'm impressed that you knew that.
I do. Yeah. Don't know much.
I didn't.
But I know that.
It's a new show called The Inspectors, which I think is a CBS family show.
Huh.
I think it premieres this weekend. I'm not positive, but it looks like a very nice group of people, very nice show. Three young actors are the main stars, and they're going to be, you're going to see a lot more of them.
Cool.
And what else?
Do you feel like there's more material out there? Because there's so many. You've got Netflix. Yes. You've got Amazon. Yes. I would think if I was an actor and actress, there's so much more out there.
There is.
Right?
The only trouble is a lot of the, like the Netflix and Amazon, none of them pay very well. You know, and that's, because they're lesser, fewer, smaller budgets. Mm-hmm. But certainly they're the way more interesting projects.
I was going to say, probably more interesting, way more meatier stuff. Although True Blood was pretty terrific.
True Blood was
cool.
To say. Yeah. So I worked a couple years on Under the Dome, which was CBS Stephen King.
I remember
series.
That. Yeah. That was good.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's exciting.
But it was fun.
You're in Open 24 Hours. I saw the demo. I mean, the clip of it.
Oh, the clip. Yeah.
It looks scary and
Do we have
juicy
that?
And.
Can we play?
Tell us about that a little bit.
It was a short film that these young, smart filmmakers got a hold of me because they were fans of True Blood and asked me to be in their movie. And I thought, well, and I like the script.
That's
and
nice of you.
It was nice of them.
But
it's
you
nice
too.
Of them.
Yeah.
But the cool thing was is that we've been accepted into maybe 20 festivals.
Wow, that's cool.
We were in the Cannes Film Festival. I mean,
did you go?
No, I didn't go. No, but it's still got about another 4 months on the festival circuit. So we've won a bunch of awards. And
it looks kind of
exciting.
Scary. Is it scary?
It's kind
or is
of
it just
scary
start
and
that
funny.
Oh,
scary,
okay.
Funny. Yeah, we shot it up in Wrightwood last winter. It was freezing cold.
But, let's see. Do we have a clip?
Okay.
Son of a bitch.
Okay, wow. What were you just saying?
I was saying we shot it from 8 p.m. to 8 a.m. because we were shooting in an actual convenience store. So that was probably shot about 3 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. People don't know you go through
all that. Yeah, the glamour of showbiz.
The wonderful glamour.
The glamour, yeah.
And it was freezing cold there, you said.
It was freezing cold. But it was fun.
Yeah.
What's been your favorite role and your favorite experience through all the years that you've been acting?
Well, I had a lot of favorites when I worked more in the theater. I really enjoyed that, of course, because it's a more communal, family kind of feeling. But I think I'd have to say True Blood just because I had such a great character and we did it for so long, and it was nice to be in a show that was a hit.
Oh, right. You know? That's a whole new thought.
We have a clip of that as well, don't we? Do we have any True Blood?
I don't think
we didn't
we
pull
do.
Any of that? Okay, mm-hmm. I thought we did. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
But everybody's seen True Blood, so who wouldn't know? But you know, one thing I'm not an actress, but I feel like TV sort of blends a little bit of theater, doesn't it? Because it's almost like every week you sort of get a new little mini play to
yes,
do.
Yes, that is true. Yeah, actually that is true. And also, if you come from the theater, and that's why I think True Blood, the actors were so good, is because Alan Ball, who was the exec producer, creator of the show. He comes from the theater, so most of his people, come from that background. So they're real strong and fast.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that helps.
He's a terrific guy. I know his wife pretty well.
Oh, yeah.
They're really, really nice people.
Oh, right.
So good there's people. A cookbook out. We've got to dive into that.
Maybe I'm thinking of somebody else for a minute. Though, wait a minute. We'll talk about that
later.
Exactly. We'll talk about that later, but go ahead. So she's got a cookbook.
I was looking at the cake on the cover of this cookbook.
Well, it's
True
not
Blood
my cookbook,
but
I have recipes in it. I don't know if we can
counts.
See this. It's called True Blood Eats, Drinks, and Bites from Bon Ton, which is the town where True Blood took place. And it's full of wacky stuff, like I have one here that apparently I made, Maxine Fortenberry, called Drop Dead Tuna Cheese Casserole.
Oh, I love this.
Yeah.
This is great.
It looks disgusting.
Let me see. Put it up there because we have a shot of the
really
cookbook.
Good,
oh, that's really funny. I love this. This
and
is terrific. Whose idea was it to do this?
I think one of the producers did it. We also have a cocktail book out, which is cool. This one is called Coleslaw Comeuppance.
Look at your picture in that. I love that.
Oh, yeah.
That's hilarious.
You can sort of see I had kind of a nasty polyester thing going on. But anyway, it's very fun, and all the characters have recipes and drinks, and you know, it was a very popular book, and the cocktail one is really fun because they're, you know, of course it's alcoholic.
Oh yeah, so that's always fun.
Yeah,
I like mixing cocktails, so I might have to check that one out.
So are you getting together with the cast now? I mean, now that you're all sort of splintered off doing your own thing.
Well, everyone's been working so much.
Yeah.
But I see the Hoyt, the guy who played my son, you know, he lives in New York now, and a couple of the other actresses I get together with. So, you know, I think everybody will always be kind of
What's your dream bond. Project, the next one? Do you want to, or just you don't care? It's about the character maybe, you know?
Yeah, I would say it would be about the character. I mean, at this point in life, I think what would I like? I'd like to have a really fun role on an episodic television show that, you know, it wasn't all about me, so I couldn't have to work too hard, but that it would be fun to be part of.
You know, as I'm sitting here with you, you have such a cheerful disposition, and that's really, she really does.
She
does. You can read that from someone's, not just their body language, but their eyes, you know, and you're wearing a smile the whole time, and I just find that lovely. That just must be how you are on the inside, but don't you feel like it's such a difficult business that it can really start to tear away
absolutely.
The layers of that kind of feeling that way?
Yes, absolutely. And certainly over the course of my career, there have been very low, bad times. You think, oh, that was the worst audition I ever gave, or they hated me, or then you don't get a job for 6 months. I mean, it's just
you start
part
to
of the deal.
It plays with your mind
it
and
It plays
your
with your mind and, you know.
I go through that with my son.
And absolutely.
He actually doesn't have it. I think it's easier for kids because
it
he's
is.
Like, I don't care. They don't like me. They don't like me. And I'm
right.
like, that's,
yeah.
I would care.
Yeah.
You should care a little bit.
You know, but at this point in life, I kind of, I feel very fortunate to have gotten this far.
You're in an indie film. That's exciting.
The Bronze?
The Bronze.
The Bronze is actually going to be.
We have a red carpet photo of you, I think, on that.
Oh, okay. Yeah. It was exciting.
Sundance.
It stars Melissa Rauch from Big Bang Theory.
She's terrific.
Great.
She's so great.
Oh, how nice to work with such terrific actors.
Yeah. She and her husband wrote it, mm-hmm. and Sony bought it, and we shot it in Cleveland.
That's my hometown.
Yes, I know. That's
Hello.
What you said. Yeah. And so
Where were you
everything's
in Cleveland?
Going on in Cleveland.
I love Cleveland. As long as I'm not living there. No offense, Cleveland. I can say that because I'm from there. But I do like it there.
Yeah.
What was it like? What did you think of it?
Well, actually, to tell you the truth, we stayed in Cleveland. We shot in
Outside.
Amherst.
Okay,
Amherst,
yeah, Amherst.
Little town.
Yep.
Uh-huh. It's very funny. Melissa plays a washed up gymnast, and you know she's a very small person, so she was a
look at her there. She's adorable.
She's so adorable and so dear. And actually, she was on True Blood. That's how we met.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, she was on one season.
Wow.
So it'll be coming out soon. So yeah.
Yeah, we'll look for that. That looks good.
Well, it's a little bit like newscasting. You know, you sort of run into people at stations, and then you don't work with them, and then all of a sudden you team up again.
It is similar business.
And then it's like similar, but different enough. Because I think I was going to say, a lot of people, they'll say when they know you're a newscaster or an anchor, they'll say, oh, did you ever want to act? It's always the first thing, at least the first thing I get.
Okay.
And I said, no, yes. The answer is usually yes, like that song, you know?
Yeah.
But it's a totally different skill set. It really is.
It's totally
because
sure.
you're
totally
reading someone else's words, and you have to know how to be that person on paper. And
right.
that's something, you know, for all the one or two acting
it's
classes I took, I found it so difficult because I couldn't step out of who I was, you know? Whereas newscasting, whatever's in my head just comes right out. And
it's easy.
Whatever I...
we just say whatever the hell we want.
It's a lot easier. Whereas
I don't know. I don't think it would be.
I don't know about that. Well, maybe not for you, right? But for me, what you do is a lot of skill.
Terrifying.
Especially an actress like you who does theater and who it's a real skill.
Well, thank you.
What's your advice to up-and-coming actors? You know, people starting out, what do you say? Because it is so up and down.
Oh, and I have a good one, too. Okay. Go ahead.
I guess I'd say several things. One is study as much as you can.
Mm-hmm.
See as many plays. See all the movies you can. Watch all the television shows so you know the vocabulary. Mm. You know the business. And then I guess the third thing I'd say is make sure you have a life.
Yeah,
because
so
otherwise
important.
You're not going to have any support. You're not going to have anything to fall back on. And you need that balance.
That's a really good point. Yeah. I'm glad you said that.
What about for women? You know, a lot of people say, eh, not you, but, you know, you're too old to be in the business.
Oh, that's
you're
a
too
good
old.
Point. We hear that all the time.
Well,
we
you
do.
Know, it doesn't apply to me because I'm a character person.
Okay.
So I don't have to worry about getting old. As a matter of fact, the older I get, the more I work.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. But if you are, you know, 35 to 40,
is it really that tough?
It is that tough because somebody's coming up behind you that's younger and fresher and more interesting maybe, and you're kind of
the
peaking.
Next best thing.
Yeah.
So in other words, wait until you're 60 again and then
and
maybe
then
you'll get
back.
Some grandma
maybe
roles.
We
is that what you're saying?
Exactly.
I think we should call
go
ourselves...
Go find something to do in the meantime.
We should call ourselves character newscasters.
Hey, you can call yourself anything. I'm still on the younger end. That's
you
how
are.
I look at it.
She's way younger than
hey.
Me.
At least,
okay.
at least
I'll
right
speak
here.
For myself.
I have really. I feel that way.
I'm a
way.
Character journalist. Good. That's my new name.
A character
you're a
journalist.
This is true. I thought I was a character journalist, but
she is. But she won't admit it.
Anyway, it's been so fun talking to you. But will you stay?
Thank you. Yeah,
because
sure.
we have a really fun person on next. And do we have to sort
it's,
of switch gears a little?
And it's about self-esteem.
And it's
so
about
it
self-esteem.
Right
so I was
Excellent.
Kind of bringing that up because, like I
sure.
said, I think it's a tough thing to do. And she writes a terrific blog. And do we need to sort of switch gears and? Put
well,
her on the camera, right? or how are we doing?
Yeah, we're going to have to switch cameras.
All right, so
switch
we'll go
cameras?
To a break
okay,
and come
go
back.
To a quick break and just come right back. Okay, break. We'll be right back.
You and I go hard at each other like we're going to war. You and I go rough. We keep throwing things and slamming the door.
Are we back on? Okay.
We got a great guest now.
We have another great, great guest. How do we position our cameras here? I'm trying to figure this out. Do we also have our beautiful actress Dale on or no?
No,
she's not. Okay.
Yeah.
I thought we were
going to
do it. You're going
to
pipe in?
Sure.
Okay, maybe
we'll
even have
you.
You know, maybe we'll even have you move over a little bit and you can sort of
no,
chime
no,
in.
No, you'll
really?
Just hear
okay.
me.
Anyway, Natasha, we've had you on before. We are in love with you. We love reading your blogs and about self-esteem and about...
Natasha Adamo.
Yep.
We should renounce who she is.
That would be great. I'm going to give you the honors. Go ahead.
I have to jump in because...
No, because I don't. So go ahead.
Postmail Syndrome is her blog and website, postmailsyndrome.com. She writes the best, most inspiring blogs that really are useful to anybody.
Thank you.
It could be about, it's really about self-esteem, I think, right? Your underlining message in all your blogs.
Yeah, my underlining message is basically to have boundaries.
Yeah.
To have boundaries.
I'm telling you, on the way here, I was on with Linda telling her about an issue that a friend of mine was having. I always seem to be the person that people go to when they have, you know, love interest problems. And I'm thinking, I got to bring this one up to her. So what have you been writing about lately? What's the latest?
Lately, I've been writing about when, you know, if you break up with someone or you get dumped or you find that you're missing your ex,
right.
which a lot of people are. You know, it's not like your logical mind will say, I know they're not good for me. I know they can't give me what I want. But it's like you don't want them to be with anyone else and you still miss them. And, you know,
you can't
make
go.
Sense of that. You can't let go. You can't make sense of it. You can't stop, you know, cyber stalking or checking up on them or wondering, you know, what happened.
Driving by their house.
Yeah, drive-bys.
You know, it essentially boils down to tying your worth to the action or inaction of someone else.
And meanwhile, you're conscious, you know you shouldn't be doing that.
Right.
But then you
yeah.
do it anyway.
How do you stop it? Because I am literally on the phone with somebody saying,
"How do you
don't drive by? Don't do it. Where are you? I'm going to come get you." And the person knows they're not supposed to be doing it, and they're driving by anyway. What do you say to somebody who simply knows what they're supposed to be doing, but they're doing the wrong thing anyway? That's the toughest thing to change, don't you think?
100%. If I had that kind of control, there wouldn't have been a blog. It's taken me years, but I think everything boils down to having boundaries, because once you instill boundaries, then you build self-esteem.
So that's what you're
by
doing,
rejecting
right.
behavior or accepting behavior of other people in a kind way, mm-hmm. Not being rude about it or voicing what your boundaries are by speaking with your actions. When you do that, you send a signal to your self-esteem and it says, okay, I just had my own back, and you start to feel better. And even though it was hard to do that and go against your libido or your heart or, whatever, that's how you build self-confidence, by saying, okay, I decided not to drive by. I'm going to reject that behavior.
You have to stop and
build
think.
Yourself
In
up.
Other words, you can't react. You have to
mindful.
Stop and think
Be
for a
mindful.
Minute. Mindful. There you go.
I'm going to throw a friend mindful. Under the bus if she's listening, but that's
oh,
okay.
Dear.
No names. And she literally knows this is not what she's to be doing, and she does it anyway. So how do you grab somebody's emotional being and sort of put it in touch with what she's supposed to be doing? Do you know what I mean? That's, I think, the hard part. Like you're saying, set boundaries. She knows to set boundaries, but she's still not setting them.
Well,
like,
she
you might know what
doesn't know. It's like saying, I know what it takes to get rich. Well, obviously you don't know because you're not rich.
Right,
you know
right,
what I mean?
Right.
If you knew, you would be rich.
Right.
You can say, I know it takes A through Z to make $100,000 a year. Well, clearly you don't know because you don't make $100,000. You know what I'm
so
saying?
So what do you tell somebody like that?
So,
if $100,000 is rich nowadays, I don't even know. I'm
that,
just saying.
That is for some a lot of people.
Yeah, I'm just making an example. So what you
in
do.
In L.A.?
Yeah, I know.
Well, for me, it took having to hit rock bottom. It took my health getting affected. It took, my emotional state getting affected. It took being ripped and stripped of any self-worth I ever had for me to have no choice but to work on it. And
why did you get caught doing something?
Not really. No, I caught myself. And I did things at the expense of my dignity. I did things at the expense of my self-respect, and not, not bad things, but just like, gosh,
what was I thinking?
I'm not that desperate. Mm-hmm. And no one is that special that loving them requires that, I have to put myself on the back burner and not love myself.
See, it's about loving mm-hmm. yourself first.
Yeah.
Don't you find, Dale?
Yes.
We've got Dale on now. That's one of the toughest things for an actor or an actress. And I know plenty of them.
Oh, yes.
And they have so many ups and so many downs. And when they're on that down flow, it's hard to come back up.
It can very much spiral. And also, as the acting profession is you're always being judged
right.
and accepted or rejected. And that's just the nature of the business part of it. So that can be very detrimental. So that's, what you're saying, Natasha, is really smart, because you do have to have that self-monitor that protects your worst self.
Of course. Boundaries, it's like your own personal electric fence. And acting, it's interesting because it's like, look at me, not be me. Give
right.
me attention for not being me. And the whole system to which you can, you get work and you climb the success ladder in the acting industry is validation seeking.
Right.
And that's, one of the worst ways to behave. And if you don't have a solid core, you're going to look to everyone and everything to tell you who you are and tell you what you're worth.
Exactly.
And that's why, there are people that are super confident that are really successful actors. And there's also people that are highly narcissistic that are super successful actors also, because, they can come across that way. But it's tough, because if you don't have that core, it could really just eat away at you.
Mm-hmm.
Really.
So how do you develop a strong core?
You develop a strong core by committing to getting behind yourself. And if you can't get behind yourself, my best advice is to go into your closet or your mom's basement, wherever, find a photo of yourself when you're at your most innocent, maybe 3-4 years old, and look at the photo and look at the kid in that photo and think, gosh, if I was walking down the street and someone was beating the crap out of that kid,
that's harsh.
Would I intervene? And if you would intervene, which I think the majority would, you're living quite hypocritically, because you're not intervening and you're emotionally beating yourself up every day. So you have to make a commitment to stick up for that child.
I think it's really important for women to hear this, especially girls, young girls, like teenagers. Mm-hmm. You have a big following with all kinds of age,
All age groups.
And I love that because I never, no one taught me that. No one taught me that. Like, my mother was has a lot of self-confidence. But, you know, I think I hid a lot of things in my life. You know, I probably did some dumb, a lot of dumb things. But I don't remember. They should have a class or something helping these helping girls develop self-esteem. It exactly. sounds so easy, yeah. but it isn't. There's a lot of peer pressure. And
especially now.
Yeah, yeah. now it's, there's television. A lot. You know, and yeah. Now think, it's all selfies and self-absorption.
Always. And but there's more. There's the internet. There's the Kardashians.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. You know, magazines, mm-hmm. models.
I mean, you got to wonder what all that. I mean, my daughter is pretty thin and she's, you know, compares herself to everybody else. That's not healthy. Right. right? I mean, that with all the selfies and this and that.
Right.
With the, yeah, the whole self-absorption thing.
Yeah,
is
and you're
difficult.
Blame absorbing as well. Or when yeah. someone, you know, hurts you, you think it's something that you did or some insufficiency on your end. And in a way, that's almost kind of like a reverse narcissism because you're continuing to make everything about you
oh,
when it's
you
not
go.
About you.
Okay, right. that's interesting. Yeah, can I give you something that happened to me this weekend? I was at a funeral.
It's not funny.
A great big Italian funeral back east. And oh boy. And this is how they are. And as soon as I walked in, I was talking to a cousin and I said, you know, how do you want to set up, for example, the bathrooms in the morning so that I'm not in anybody's way and we're all not stepping on each other. And everything is always in a front and always. And I find that I'm trying to make it better all the time. Like, oh, but no, that's not what I meant. Or, you know, we were at the restaurant and you know how they have something prefixed and it was like a lot of lasagna and blah, blah, blah. And I said, is it okay? Can I get something else? And my aunt from the other end said, do you have to be so fancy all the time? And, you know, you know, like, what's the matter with you? So, and, you know, and I'm trying to always make it better. So my point is, anything I did, I always tried to overcompensate so that I was liked and mm-hmm. that I made it better. And that's just another example of how I think girls, women, mm-hmm. will try and make it better. That, oh, really, I'm not so bad. And that's just a mild example, don't you think? But
very mild, yeah. I think the best way to kind of fix that pattern is to first notice the pattern that you're doing, which you do.
I did it all weekend.
And, you know, you have to own your actions and words and let other people own theirs and let the chips fall as they may. And you have to communicate clearly through your actions. Words, when you talk a lot about what's right and what's not or what hurt and what
so
didn't,
true.
You're giving people ammunition to switch them around. When you talk mm-hmm. with your actions, it's great because
yeah,
people can't
like
mince
that.
Words, and you also are forever on the white horse because you're the one that didn't get involved, stayed classy, and was a lady, and you know, let people kind of react.
Detach a little bit.
I kind of like that. Stay classy yeah. and be a lady. That's,
right.
a, mm-hmm. that's a really good
that's
one.
That's something
if you
we forget, too.
We
why
do
are you
forget
laughing?
That, yes.
But yeah, the reverse narcissism thing is interesting.
It's
I mean,
true.
There's so much narcissism. I don't care if it's reverse or moving forward. It's everywhere. And I feel like society, what's going to happen? I mean, it's not, what's going to, where are we going to go from all these selfies and all the narcissism? Where's it going to take us in the next 5 years?
I find them difficult to constantly look like. Do you, Dale?
Oh, sure.
All the time.
Like
I'm
already.
Thinking, oh my gosh, geez, I didn't get invited to that girls' night last
yeah,
night.
It makes
that's
you
dangerous.
Feel like
and they're
you
all
have
like this. They're
yeah.
all having a good time.
I don't even post. I don't
like the.
It's
to
like
put where I am.
No,
and, you know, and then I don't know. Then you're hurting people's feelings.
Right.
And
it's like
also,
my like is so
who cares?
Great.
No one cares.
You know?
Just
no.
about everyone I know posts hourly, and they're all oh. posting it. Look where I was today, and look what set I'm on.
Now
look
I'm
what
with
I'm doing,
this person.
And,
now I'm with that.
And look where yeah. I'm traveling. And I love the one where they're clearly on a tarmac. By a private plane, right? And you know that what they're trying to say is, look at me, I'm not flying Delta.
F you, I'm
yeah.
on my private.
I'm on a
coach.
Private one. And I'm thinking, come on, you know, what are you trying to
so
say
I,
here?
You know, that brings
you know?
Up a good point when you're in the fields that both of you are in. Do you, I mean, you have Facebook and I don't know, do you, Dale? Because
mm-hmm.
you're an actress, so you
mm-hmm.
have to do some of that.
Yes.
But there's
mm-hmm.
a fine line. So how much do you do? I always wonder that because
I kind of
you don't
go
want...
through fits and starts.
Yeah.
I mean, Riley, my publicist, is always kind of after me to be a little more involved on Twitter. And
but then you don't want to be a show
you know,
off.
But then
and,
it's
yeah.
like relentless self-promotion. And
yeah.
It's almost embarrassing.
Like,
and
it's
you're
embarrassing.
Like, oh boy. So
yeah.
that's what Riley's there for. He can
yeah.
do, he can Twitter for you. Right?
Yeah, make Riley
but
do it.
You, Natasha, you're reaching people in a very real way.
Yeah,
and,
you're
advising them and helping them. It's a different thing
different
than
thing.
Like, oh, I'm
yeah.
on TV again. Look
here
at me.
Here I am in this
you know,
show.
Yeah.
I agree.
So I think for you, it's just part of your business, I would imagine.
That's a little different.
Yeah.
You're right. Because
yeah.
she's really out there helping people.
Exactly.
And what she has to say, the more she says it, the more people she reaches.
And the more
so I'm with
you.
You
reach, you know, that's very valuable.
Do you get a lot of responses from your blogs? You know, people saying thank you so much. And has anyone sent you a story recently about something that you really helped them with? I love that you're there doing that for these people.
Yeah, I get.
Including me.
I get hundreds of emails.
Yeah.
I've had so many just heartbreaking stories, funny stories, but all of them boil down to the fact that I'm clearly not alone in my experiences and my feelings and my emotions. And, you know, going back to what you were saying about the private plane and the Instagramming, you know, it's one thing to, you know, hold your latte with the latte art, with your Rolex, with your shoes, and get it from up above and, you know, try to create an image. But I say it in my blog, when you're really good at something, you got to tell everyone. And when you're great, they tell you. And,
I like that.
That's great.
So much wisdom. I think more people need to remember that.
How'd you get so much wisdom?
A lot of pain.
Life
lessons.
A lot
of pain. A lot
of,
you know.
How much pain did you go through?
I had a lot of pain.
For goodness sakes, you're a young girl. I mean, honestly.
A lot of pain, a lot of caring way too much about what other people thought, mm-hmm. a lot of making other people's behavior about me, a lot of, you know, I still deal with it. Half the time I'm writing a post, I'm convincing myself of it. You know, I'm
fallible. I'll bet you that's, very true.
Of course,
it's almost, it's very cathartic for you, isn't it? Everything
100%.
You write, you're like, that's it. That's what I got to do. 100%. That's it, right?
If I was this healed, you know, all-knowing being, I wouldn't be interesting. No one would be commenting. They would log off.
Right.
Yeah,
because people feel a connection.
We're always evolving. Everyone's always evolving. So there's always lessons every day.
I just call my girlfriends.
She called. Yeah. And by the way, the girlfriend you're talking about is not me.
No, that's not true.
Just to be clear. Because we have people that know we're friends, and they'll say, what's wrong with it's not me. I just have to point that out. Yeah, it's good to talk about these issues because there's really nowhere to go. Like, my daughter doesn't share. She'll talk to her friends, but, you know, the whole point when you're a mom, you want them to come to you, and a lot of times they don't. So I like that you offer that platform for young people, all ages, really, to read and learn and grow from it and get positive.
Yeah, I try to have people, I mean, go to themselves first because forget the ex, forget your mom, forget your dad.
Yeah.
I mean, the one person you'll never be able to do without their validation
yourself.
Or their love is yourself.
Right.
That's it.
How did you start your blog?
I started it after just getting sick of giving, you know, dating advice to friends mm-hmm. and kind of hitting a point where I felt like I had something to say and getting to a point where I wanted to express myself without being edited and without having to deal with anyone. And I thought, okay, I'm just going to kind of see what happens. Mm-hmm. And I started going. And I wanted to see, too, if I was alone in my experiences and my thoughts and all kinds of that. And I knew I had something to say. So I just figured I'd put it out there.
It's great.
It's really wonderful. Cool. How's your movie coming? Are you still doing that?
It's good, yeah.
Girlfriends? Is that
aren't we in it? Talk about narcissism. I thought that. Aren't you putting us in it?
Yeah, we have to do some pickup shots.
We have to do
shots,
a scene in here.
Right now. I mean, I'm telling
that
you.
That would be great.
No, but really, how is it coming?
It's going really well. Yeah. Yeah, it's going really well.
Sounds like a movie I really want to see.
Yeah,
I mean,
everything I write is heartbreak-based comedy.
Love that.
Right. Yeah. Women can relate to that, certainly.
Maybe you could put Dale in the movie, too.
Well, yeah, that would be great.
I will.
We got everybody working. We're like a little
sure.
family
yeah.
in here.
Be together.
I would love it. I mean, it's our common denominator. You know, everyone, no matter what language, culture, we've all experienced heartbreak, pain,
and you don't
insecurity.
Ever forget.
Never.
I mean, I've been married forever, but still you remember those
yeah,
ones in high school.
You're lucky, Dale. You're lucky.
I am.
What is your background with your family? Because I know you've been married for forever, as you said.
Well, I was married early in life, and that didn't last. And then my husband Ray and I have been married for 30 years, and we've been together for 40 years.
How nice.
That's beautiful.
God. What's the secret?
Well, you know what I...
he listens?
He's a wonderful person. But I think a good part of it is that we chose not to have children.
Yeah, that's right there.
What did I just say yesterday?
That's the secret right there.
I have three boys. And let me tell you,
God.
Raising them, it's the one thing that's gotten in between us because
yes.
we parent differently. I'm stricter.
He and I would not be on the same page.
I'm stricter. And I'll walk in and say, you're not their friend. You're the dad. And he's like, well, and he's generally a pretty tough guy. But when it comes to his boys, mm-hmm. so I get it right there.
That's a good one.
Very helpful.
Oh, well, he can't take people back, right? So it's
exactly.
Yeah. And then so no kids is the secret. Beyond that, no, I'm kidding. But beyond that.
I just like him. I still like him. And he's, we're also in the same business, which is helpful, I think.
Yeah.
And what does he do?
He's a lighting designer at CBS.
Mm-hmm.
So he gets it.
He gets all of it.
He gets all the horrible hours and, you know.
What you have to go through as an actress.
Exactly. And he goes through pretty much on a daily basis. So,
yeah,
you know, that's helpful.
Well, that's great.
Yeah. So that's what I say about having a life. It's very helpful.
You need a balance. You definitely do. You need it for self-esteem purposes, too. You've got to have some hobbies. I don't have any hobbies anymore. Who does?
You got to have something to go off of.
We go hiking.
I don't know.
You know, someone asked me the other day, what are your hobbies? I go, who the hell has time for hobbies? I don't have time. Do you?
That's a good point. All right, what's your hobby? Look, Dale's like, I don't know.
I like to read, but then I feel guilty.
Sort of a hobby. I know.
But I know friends who do needlework.
I do, too. What are you doing today? I'm going to a bookmaking class. Yeah. I'm like, what?
How do you have time to do that?
Nothing.
I don't have time to do that.
My hobby is going out, having a drink, and I like it.
And socializing with friends.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, probably. But, I mean, people paint and...
Yeah, that's kind of nice.
You know, what painting. Else? Knit, and I guess.
Knit?
I don't know. I don't know anyone who knits.
I've never been much of it. I do, but I know people who do this stuff, and I would think, I can't, you know. Yeah. I would try doing it in, you know, school or whatever, and my scarves would always come out crooked, and for me, I walk, I hike, hobby. I listen to other people, right?
Right.
What about you? What's your hobby? Helping people?
Yeah, I like helping people. I like relaxing and socializing and eating and going to great restaurants and,
So it's more lifestyle. Enjoyable stuff. That's like me. Yeah. Same thing. I mean, if people say, what do you do? Same with acting. It's almost, it's a part of your life. Yeah. It's almost like it's your whole, sort of your hobby.
It's your hobby and your work and everything else.
You think about in the old days whenever they were people quilted and...
Yeah, they had a lot more time.
They had a lot more time.
We don't have time.
There was no internet. There was no Facebook.
That's the thing. We're on that website all.
Yeah.
You know, everybody's online.
Time to quilt? Yeah. You know, I have pieces of my mom's.
No offense to the quilters out
there. No, I'm sure it's lovely. But I have pieces of my mom's garments when she passed. And somebody said, make a quilt of it. So I grabbed a bunch of her pants and shirts. And now I have some stuff for my dad's because he just passed. And it's just been one of those couple of years.
Yeah.
And I have all this stuff trying to make a quilt. I'm like, I am
never gonna make a quilt.
You'll come over and we'll make a quilt.
I am not making a quilt.
So you can take it to a quilter.
Yeah.
And they would make a quilt.
Yeah.
It's kind of a nice idea though.
It is.
But I think you need to have someone do it for you.
But my point is, who quilts?
I tried to paint once. I bought all this really fancy paint and all these boards and I did one painting and I said, this is terrible. And then, you know, I spent probably $1,000 on all this stuff.
On all this stuff.
And there it is in my garage. You know, this is how I do hobbies. I think I could do this. I could do this.
Yeah.
I like contemporary art. I'm going to make my own art. And then I do it, and it's terrible. You know, and I realize this is harder than it looks.
Yeah. It also requires a lot of concentration. You really have to stay with something.
I don't have that.
And if you're splintered in many different directions, that's hard to do. I know. I am. A lot of us are, right? We're sort of all over, especially when you have three kids and you're just running all over and friends and work and all that kind of stuff. So your next move is what? You've got this great book that you brought for us today. And
I'm going to do a play, actually.
Oh, tell me about that, because I love theater. Would it be here in Los Angeles?
Yeah, it's going to be at the Skylight Theater on Vermont, and it's called Forever House.
Ooh.
And it's a premiere. And
we want to make sure we go to that.
I want to go.
It's going to be good. It's actually going to be good. We start rehearsal December 1st, and we'll open sometime in January.
That's very exciting. I love to go see friends in shows.
Well, good.
I'm from New York, so I would go to almost any theater available. So I love doing that.
So we can go out after.
That would be fun.
Great spots over
there. I love theater, too.
That would be a lot of fun. Would that be a nice evening out?
It's interesting to learn all these places to go in L.A.
And
people that aren't in L.A. There's a lot of great theater in certain, you know, communities.
One of our hosts here, Carolyn Hennessy, she's in a play here as well.
Oh, she's a wonderful
Do you know
actress.
Carolyn? Oh, she's fantastic.
She's a wonderful actress.
She is marvelous. And I'm trying to get a group of us together if you want
to
go. And I
to
think
see
it's
hers?
Yes. And I think it's running to the end of this month. That's something also that we should all go see. That'd be fun. So, and your next... endeavor would be just to keep writing and keeping us all in
keeping us all on track. I want to write a book. I want to turn it into a book.
So you've got the movie.
I've got the movie. I've got the blog that I'm just doing every day.
Do you give speeches? Because I think you would be fantastic up there. Because you're sort of a walking testament for what you should be, especially for young girls.
Thank you. I would love to. I would love to. I've been asked by a couple sororities, but no, I would absolutely love to speak and help. I love helping girls. I love helping women.
That'd
and
be great.
I'm totally against
They need a role model like you.
Thank you.
It's better
thank
than
so
certain
much.
Celebrities.
I still, there's no doubt, but I still think just like exercising your core, the toughest thing mentally is to get your core in shape. I really believe that.
100%.
I just don't know how you get that across to people as they're driving past that guy's house and feeling
the drive-by again.
Well, how do you get your core in shape as they keep going and they're on the phone saying, I know I shouldn't be doing
stop
this.
Stop and listen, right?
Well, you know,
And I really
You've
mean it.
You've got to understand that every time you do something like that, you're chipping away at your self-worth. And I think people know that. And I think if you look at an addict, for instance, like, you know, drugs and alcohol, the first thing you do at AA is you acknowledge, I am powerless to this addiction. Mm-hmm. So one thing with AA I do not agree with. You're basically saying, hand me a gun. Let me just shoot myself right now because I have no control over this. I come from a place, and I think AA is amazing. You know, I think it's highly successful. I think it's great. But I come from a different approach where I'm saying, you have the control. You are behind the wheel of the ship. Mm-hmm. You can drive it. And you know that what you're engaging in is hurting you. So just take a fraction, one fraction, not the whole thing, a fraction of the energy you are putting into obsessing about someone that has consistently failed to see your worth, and just one fraction, just try to do something for
step
yourself
at a
and
time.
See how it happens. See, you know,
then
see
it will
how it
build.
Works out. Yeah,
I
you're
like
not
that.
Powerless to it. You are actually powerful, and you can dictate how you feel about something, and you're not that desperate, you know, mm-hmm. not that pathetic, you're not that desperate, and no one is that special that loving them requires that you become an FBI agent. You know,
right?
I mean. But also, you can't change how like someone is attracted to you. That's another thing. So if you keep going after somebody because you think that maybe that's a way to pull them in, if anything, it pushes them away.
It does, yeah.
It totally does. And you know, we end up finding that we're attracted to people. And we're drawn to people that mirror the way we feel and we treat ourselves.
That's a good
point.
So
if you treated yourself better, you're not going to have any time for someone that treats you less than you're to treat you.
What you have inside is what you project, and that's what you get back.
Right.
It's
and
all
if
energy.
You're attracted to someone that can't see your value, that's a huge red flag that you need to stop thinking about them and start
work
thinking
on
about
yourself.
You know, working on you. Right. And that's hard. That's scary. And that's what I try to help girls with.
Well, if you have
and
low
men.
Expectations, they will definitely be met.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
That's a good
point. That's a great point.
Yeah.
It's true.
Mm-hmm. Well, aren't we fantastic,
well, yes,
all
we
of
are.
Us? We have got it together, all of us.
I don't. I'm not going to tell
do.
You what. No.
Well, this has been a really good, informative, inspiring session. I feel like we were in therapy.
I do, too. So next up, we're going to go to your play.
Yeah. Okay, great. I
okay.
would love it.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for
My
bringing
pleasure.
Your book.
It was
Thank you for sharing about True Blood
and for
everything.
The acting tips. We love
well,
that.
your son's going to do great.
Oh, thanks. He'll be appreciative to listen to what you had to say. And Natasha, as always, you're
Thank
beautiful
you.
Inside and out. We
Thank
love you,
you
so
Thank
much.
Thank you for having me on.
All right, everyone.
Anyway, thanks for being here. We'll see you next week for another version of Shut Up with Deborah and Linda. Thanks again. See you next week.